అంటే మాట్లాడతా. ఈరోజు నిజామాబాద్లో మనోరమా సూపర్ స్పెషాలిటీ హాస్పిటల్లో ఒక అరుదైన చికిత్స జరిగింది. దానికి మామూలుగా గర్భిణీ స్త్రీలకు మా ప్లాసెంటా అంటే మావి అనేది యుట్రస్కి లోనే ఉంటుంది, అది కొంచెం దాని కండరాల్లోకి పోయి అతుక్కుపోయినప్పుడు బాగా డెలివరీ టైంలో బాగా బ్లీడింగ్ అయ్యి పేషెంట్కి చాలా సీరియస్ కావచ్చు. ఒక్కొక్కసారి యుట్రస్ తీసేసినా కూడా పేషెంట్ ప్రాణాలు కూడా పోయే ఛాన్సెస్ ఉంటాయి. అట్లాంటి అరుదైన కేసెస్కి మనము ఇప్పుడు ఆ యుట్రస్ని సేవ్ చేయడం, పేషెంట్ని సేవ్ చేయడానికి కొత్తగా ఒక ఇంటర్వెన్షన్ రేడియాలజీ ద్వారా మేము పేషెంట్ని సేవ్ చేశాము. ఎక్కువ బ్లీడింగ్, బ్లడ్ లాస్ కాకుండా దానికి మన హాస్పిటల్కి డాక్టర్ వెంకటేశ్వర్లు, వెరీ వెల్ నోన్ ఇంటర్వెన్షనల్ రేడియాలజిస్ట్ ఫ్రమ్ హైదరాబాద్ సార్, చాలా చాలా సీనియర్ నిజాం హైదరాబాద్లో, ఆల్రెడీ కేర్ హాస్పిటల్లో, బీబీఆర్ హాస్పిటల్లో, మెడ్విన్లో చాలా ఎక్స్పీరియన్స్ ఉన్నారు. ఆయన మేము రిక్వెస్ట్ చేయగానే కాదనకుండా వచ్చి ఆ పేషెంట్కి దాంట్లో బ్లీడింగ్ కాకుండా ఆర్టరీలో బెలూనింగ్ అని చేసేసి దానికి సేవ్ చేశారు. దానికి ఎంతో కృతజ్ఞతలు. ఇప్పుడు మీరు డాక్టర్ వెంకటేశ్వర్ గారితో ఆయన ద్వారానే ఈ విశేషం వినండి. థ్యాంక్ యూ.
ఎక్కువ బ్లీడింగ్ ఆఫ్ చేసేదానికి కొన్ని పద్ధతులు ఉన్నాయి ఈ ప్రొసీజర్స్లో. ఈ కేసులో మేము చేసామంటే ఒక రైట్ గ్రాయిన్ దగ్గర చిన్న పంక్చర్ తీసుకొని అక్కడ నుండి ఒక షీత్ ఇంట్రడ్యూస్ చేసి దాని నుండి ఒక బెలూన్, అంటే ఒక 20 mm సైజ్ బెలూన్ అయోట అంటే అది రక్తం సప్లై చేసే రక్తనాళం, పెద్ద రక్తనాళం అది. దాంట్లో ఒక బెలూన్ ఇన్ఫ్లేట్ చేస్తే కింద రక్తం స్టాప్ అయిపోయింది. అట్లా ఒక 10 minutes బ్లాక్ చేసిన తర్వాత ప్రొసీజర్ బ్లీడింగ్ లాగ్.
వెల్కమ్ టు ద సిఎంఈ ఆర్గనైజ్డ్ బై ద మనోరమ హాస్పిటల్. ఐ కాల్ డాక్టర్ చంద్రశేఖర్ రావు ఆన్ టు ద డయాస్, అవర్ చైర్మన్ ద మనోరమ హాస్పిటల్. ఇట్ విల్ టేక్ సమ్ మోర్ టైమ్ టు కమ్ టు సిగ్నటరీస్ ఆఫ్ ఐఎంఏ. మీన్ వైల్ విల్ స్టార్ట్ ద ప్రోగ్రామ్. ఐ ఇన్వైటెడ్ టుడే స్పీకర్ డాక్టర్ to give us some knowledge about interventional radio. So they are on the way, but we'll start the program. Our chairman Begar, who is the main surgeon of today's procedure, also the procedure. Now I invite Dr. Chandrasekhar Rao garu to brief about the hospital and few points about this
hospital, that is Manorama Super Speciality Hospital. We have conducted so many deliveries which are complicated and really they are rare. They are to go to Hyderabad, but we have done surgeries and we have saved so many mothers having more pain. Now without losing much time, today we have done a rare surgery, and the surgery for behind it Dr. Venkateshwarlu, who is a intervention radiologist who has come all the way from Hyderabad to Nizamabad. I welcome you, sir, to your hospital, and with his help Rama has performed C-section for the second gravida patient, and without much problem the case has been completed. Now I want Dr. Rama to say a few words about the patient and the surgery. Thank you very much, sir. Thank you a lot.
Thank you, ma'am.
Surgical aspects.
Dr. Venkateshwar garu,
husband, Dr. Chandrasekhar, and all my friends and seniors, everybody who has come now. Actually, my passion has been high-risk obstetrics from the beginning. And since I have worked in government hospital without much of any equipment or support, we used to handle all bad cases, rupture uterus, accidental hemorrhages, placenta previas. And most of the times, I don't know, God always used to save the patients in government hospital, because even though with low facilities, not much of a maternal mortality we used to see. My colleague is there, Lakshmi, at that time. We all used to do, but not so. Even status eclampsia also we used to manage in government setup. But of late our situation has become bad, and then and more new technology is developing, and to save the patients, and then with not much of morbidity also trend, and get into a new techniques, and then have a peaceful practice actually. So after we have started this Manorama Super Speciality Hospital, have been backed up by critical care people, cardiologists, and then all other doctors who are anesthetists, who are very good associates now. They are we are doing. So placenta accreta was referred by Dr. Dwaraka to me long back, when she was only central placenta, it was diagnosed, and she came to me. So we followed her up, and then slowly she was going into placenta accreta. So at 37 weeks when I got, there was not much of gap between the myometrium and the bladder. I have decided to conduct a elective C-section. So last week when Dr. Dayasagar had come here, he saw our cath lab and he said it's so good, and then you should utilize for other than cardiology also. There are so many things you can do. You can contact an interventional cardiologist.
Radiologist.
So my friend, my classmate, and we were good friends, Dr. Saraswati, she is the director of blood bank in BVR hospital. Her husband is Dr. Venkateshwar Garu, and I knew him. Most of our Nizamabad gynecologists know him. Maybe we did not see him. We all know, because we are all sending FTCs to him in Medwin and CARE, and he is doing it, and so many times he is helping our infertility patients. So I thought about him, and one fine day, Sunday we went and met him. So he was very kind, and he accepted, okay, whenever you keep the case, I will come and do it. So I was actually thrilled to demonstrate that sort of cases, because we don't see here, and we refer the cases to Hyderabad whenever accretas are there. Previously, when by knowing or unknowingly we open up the placenta accreta, and all of us will learn lesson, because the patient will require 10 to 12 bottles of blood, and she will go into DIC, and so much of morbidity, and economically, and also tension for us. If suppose so many times we lose the patient also on the table, at that time financially also we are at loss, with so much of psychological stress for at least a month or two. Then when sir said this is very simple, you can save and all, then I planned it, and thank you very much sir, you have come. And those who have attended in the morning saw the surgery. Emundi akrita inta simple ga ayipindi anipinchindi, kani when we are doing in that remote gush of blood, he said, whenever you want, you tell me, I will inflate the bulb. Then first incision only gush of blood has come, and then we try to remove the placenta. Anteriorly in the lower segment, there was attached pieces. We were trying, and he said, please inflate. The moment he inflated, in a matter of, say, 10 seconds, the field has become completely bloodless, and I was doing a normal C-section and nicely suturing, and I saw it, and he said, you check it up, if there is no bleeding, I'll deflate it. We waited, because we have to do tubectomy and all of that for her, and we pushed the uterus, and we saw per vaginum also there was no bleeding, and sir has deflated. Waited for some more time, there is nothing, he removed the balloon, and the surgery was over. It was so simple, and then so, you know, I was thrilled to do that case. So I am so happy. That, and now we can pull up cases, and sir, me permission lekunda antunna, we can pull up cases and call him, and then we have 2-3 cluster previous cases at a time. So whenever he comes, he can have cases, and we, without much of morbidity and blood loss to the patient, we can do the sections and save both mother and child. So this is an experience for me. And I'm really thankful for all the gynecologists who have come in the morning. Mostly almost 30 members have come, and they saw a real live demonstration of this surgery. And now you all have come, and sir will tell us where all this interventional radiology is going to help us in saving the patient lives. Thank you very much, sir. So finally, he got one case. They said, okay, you keep one donor ready and one. But actually, for here, I don't think we require to transfuse that one blood also. Maybe because we have brought, we have transfused, but otherwise there is not much of blood loss. Any normal cesarean section, 500 ml is expected. That much only we lost, not many. Only three mops were full. That's all. Thank you very much.
17 and 18. I really thank Chandrasekhar Rao and also Dr. Venkateshwarlu for bringing a new technology to the Nizamabad, which is very much essential. Most of the times, when we were talking the day before yesterday, most of the complicated cases are being attended and treated here, but they are not being reported. And for simple problems which can be solved here, we can treat the patients and good rapport with the patients, good name in the society. So I request all of my colleagues to utilize the services of technology wherever it may be, whether it is in the Manorama or somewhere else. We have to use technology, available technology, which can be done here, so that patient will be benefited, and our Nizamabad name will also be in the number one position in the service organization, the service. And in this regard, we talk to each other. Every month, it is from next month onwards, we want to bring a news bulletin, IMA news bulletin every month, and because Raghavendra has run many mass cases, and this case, any interesting case, government hospital also, they are doing excellent these things. We can collect such things, and every month we can send a newsletter so that what exactly is going on here. And first of all, we know which case we have to send to the IELTS center, either or otherwise, the patient will be treated here. I thank you, Chandrasekhar Rao sir, for bringing one new technology, and sir also for introducing us the technology. Definitely, I think all of people who have attended in the afternoon get benefited. Most of the time, this is a gynecology obstetrics, so that's why more I'm not seeing many persons in the evening. Thank you very much.
I'm present with abstract. My abstract is this tumor. This what would be a simple way, angiogram. You can see this is a tumor vascularity. We embolize with a gel foam or a particles. Post procedure, it will be operated. So again, hematuria is one of the problem. Most of the times, hematuria is mainly the iatrogenic hematuria, either renal biopsy or post PCNL, rather than other causes. There may be other etiologies for that, but most of the times it is a post-PCNL hematuria, that is more problematic, and we'll be seeing more cases. And rarely renal biopsy also one of the causes, and rarely a surgical, after surgery or renal surgery also, there is some hematuria that can be managed. So you can see this is a 13-year-old man, undergoes PCNL, tenders prior. He presents with mass hematuria and transfusion given. So generally this is a renal angiogram that shows there is a damaged vessel. This diagnosis is pseudoembolism. So most of the times, any post PCNL hematuria is not subsiding, then it is referred to angiogram. You can see now this is it's a video clip. Now you can see the pseudoembolism. The treatment is simple. just we go through the micro decision. And the prior to these procedures, it was a nephrectomy which was done. So we can just go to a small vessel where we can just embolize that vessel. And in this case, the glue was used. It's called N-butane cyanoacrylate. We don't have embolic materials, liquid embolic materials. So now we can see this is a post embolization. See, enter kidney becomes a small part of the branches now. So the advantage of intervention. Again, GA bleed is a massive GA bleed, upper GA, lower GA is one of the problem for surgeons, gastroenterologists, physicians. So what would this? Iatrogenic, lab coli, open surgery, liver biopsy, drainage, all these procedures can get iatrogenic etiology. Then trauma in aneurysm. So you can see the advent of advanced imaging that has given a diagnostic, it gives a diagnosis most of the time to treat. So you can see this is a CT angiogram of abdominal aorta. So how nicely the anatomy is depicted. You can see this is a celiac artery. So this is a supramesenteric artery. And you can see this again from gastrodon, there is aneurysm is there. So you present it massively. So this CT angio, this is I mean diagnosis, then it is simple, I mean to go for treatment. So you can see now you can just magnify this aneurysm. So in this case, these aneurysms are the gastrodenal artery connects both hepatic artery and supramesenteric artery. So these aneurysms should be treated by, I mean, pre and post, I mean, how to put coils or embolic material in both the places. How it is done? This is a just animation, celiac artery, this is a supramesenteric artery. If you embolize one place, there will be a collateralization and a patient bleeds again. So you have to do on both sides. So this is a coil, you can just, so proximally and distally it is blocked, so then aneurysm is closed. So this is the case we have done. So I put a distal one coil there and I get proximally injected in blue. So in between the aneurysm has, it will close, otherwise it will recanalize and bleed. And there is no further bleed. This is again 31 man, known case of pancreatitis, present with a massive GA bleed. So initial, these are the initial images, you can see this is a calcific pancreatitis, there is nothing there, small pseudocyst here, it has grown and he present with a jaundice. So this large pseudo and GA bleed. You can see the ruptured and also there is intraabdominal blood. So in this case, we not treated the jaundice. What we treated was, this is aneurysm, it is a CT, a contrast CT, large pseudo aneurysm. So what we did again, from gastrodenal artery, we went down distally, here this is the distal, yes, we placed the coils there and you can see, and proximal coils. This is a post-embolization picture, this is a coil in the DDC, this is a distal place and this is a proximal. So we injected the supramesenteric artery, there is no filling. So these are the coils. So jaundice also subsided. So it is treated in jaundice by the other way. Again, visceral artery is revascularization. That is, we sent it actually. Most of the time they present with postprandial pain and weight loss. This young lady, 20 years lady, postprandial pain, loss of weight, vomiting. No, as I told you, CT angio gives most of the times the diagnostic. Diagnosis, and only thing is we have to treat. This is a CT. You can see the CT angio shows there is a tight stenosis here, celiac angio, and this is again demonstrated nicely here. So what we do is we did an angioplasty. See again angio shows this stenosis here. Here is the SMA angio. So you can just go and put a stent there. These are the stents used. Okay.
So patient became asymptomatic. So this is a treatment for visceral arteries. They're post-entry. No procedural complications.
Okay.
Yeah, mainly most of the here to the audience is the gynecologist more. I think we will concentrate more on this. Obstetric and gynecologic hemorrhage. Postpartum hemorrhage is a primary and secondary. What we today did is a primary, to prevent a primary postpartum hemorrhage, we did a procedure today. Most of the times in world literature, it is the 80% to 90% of the time is that to treat the primary hemorrhage, that is within 24 hours of the is that any delivery or severe and there is a primary hemorrhage. Decrease is there, but I had worked out cases of 200 cases, around 95% are secondary postpartum hemorrhage. So we are not doing much in the primary postpartum hemorrhage. So just we go through 27-year-old man, severe delivery, bleeding. So I mean, she had a 3 bleeds actually. And unfortunately, the imaging is not good actually. Ultrasound, most of the places is not done properly, not done by the proper people. So most of the time, you can miss. So you can see this angiogram, this abnormal iatrogram. We look for any ovarian supply. Most of the time, it should be abdominal aortic angio. To look for ovarian supply. So this is a left internal iliac angio. Now you can see this is a left internal iliac angio. That shows there is a large pseudoaneurysm rising from the internal. So management is simple. I mean, once a suspicion is there, the imaging modality is properly done ultrasound and Doppler or a CT angio. That gives the idea that the patient has a problem. So once you know the diagnosis, just in this case, we can give the bulk material gel foam, coils and glue. So these are the coils and bulk materials. So the gel foam is available everywhere, so in the OT. So what we do is most of the time, 90% of time we use gel foam. That is cheaper. It is available everywhere. And the procedure cost is less. And it works. That is the thing important. In all the cases, we have bilateral embolization, though there is an embolism on one side, but there may be a chance of some recanalization from the other side, would be a bilateral block of the both internal arteries. So, this you can see, this is a case from Nanded actually. So, you can see this in Marathi. She had a severe end, that's 3 episodes of massive bleeds. It was not diagnosed, unfortunately. So, when they are referred to us, so this is an angiogram. See, had an aneurysm there. Again, see, this is an intracranial. So, just embolize a few gel foam lesions. The right side. So, this is a post-embolization. And see, she conceived again. So, this is just we did ultrasound. So, immediately she conceived, but somebody can call this advice abortion. Next, when she conceived, next they came to us. So they advised them, that's not good. I said nothing. So she conceived and she again, this is a case what I was talking. The gynecologist generally in a massive bleed, they try to, ligate the internal iliac, sometimes extract all those things. This is a classical case. This is from a surgeon from Guntur actually. So, when she was bleeding massively, we told whether we can send. No, I said no, we cannot send this with bleeding because hypotension. So, what he has done was, he told I will ligate the arteries and we just remove and again, if the arteries are ligated, so road is blocked. So, embolization cannot be done. So, always there is a chance, I mean, don't block the road. That is the concept. So, what he has done is, just he has ligated and just stabilized the patient and referred to us. So, with our surgeon is there, just he opened it and removed the sutures. And we did angio. There is a massive vascularity, you can see, also some massive vascularity. And you can see the suture is removed and this massive aspirate which was embolized and packed so the diagnosis was we did a CT for some reason and she had a choriocarcinoma with lung mets also. So then she received a chemotherapy and, because we thought what is happening, we did HCG, it was very high number, so just we get chemotherapy, we get chemotherapy. So it can be even case-based situation. Again, this is in a post-abortion situation and ultrasound showed the large unnatured area. So always anything, we have to put a color. In ultrasound, we see some unnatured area, put a color, this is a large unnatured. The fundus of the uterus. See, this is a large aneurysm after post-abortion DNC. See, this is an aneurysm. I mean, once you know the diagnosis, treatment is simple. And we just embolize, this is a post procedure Doppler, there is nothing. Simply, it is thrombosing. It is getting thrombosed.
Then you
didn't drain out your
aneurysm?
Yes, you can. So again, fibroids is one area. We know any symptomatic fibroids can be treated. So the concept is there, the vessels which supply to the fibroids are hypertrophied. We select a embolic material which goes into that. If there is any smaller vessels, they don't enter. So generally concept is the bigger particles, they won't enter into the normal blood vessels. So they enter only into the hypertrophied vessels. Always the fibroids have a hypertrophied vessel. So they won't affect the myometrium. They just go to the fibroid. That is the concept of fibroid embolism. Generally we use the particles, gelcom is also used. Generally they are treated the symptomatic fibroids. Initially there was a concern that large fibroids, pedunculated fibroids, subsidiary fibroids, cervical fibroids should not be embolized. And if there is a pertinent issue, should not embolize. But these are all the indications now, except for the fibroid embolization. So this is a one case, and the patient had a 23 centimeters fibroid, 23 centimeters, unmarried. So most of the times, the married people, they may do, I mean, this comes to you, you do a strict, then just finish it. But unmarried, this thing, so they don't, I mean, they came to us. Just we did a retinal embolization. So this is a fibroid, this is a post procedure fibroid, the MR. So you can see how much is it. This is almost a subsidiary fibroid. So you can see, I mean, it totally devascularized. You can see this is the uterus and this is the uterus. This is after 1 year. And it has reduced in size. And it has totally impacted. This is another lady. So this is almost following for 9 years. Yesterday I talked to her, actually she ran up to me. Her fibroid has decreased to 1.5 or 15 millimeters. See, this you can see her fibroid size was initially 18 millimeters. We embolized, then it decreased. Once it has come down to around 8 centimeters, she conceived. She conceived. So this is the angio. This angio, this is this done in a small size MR, so pictures are not good. So decrease. Yesterday only just I ran to her. I mean, so the ultrasound recently showed the 15 millimeters. So generally, whenever they ask us, we say the fibroid will decrease up to 50 to 60%. But it has gone complete, almost 90%. So, other end placenta, I mean, just today, generally, this is a type of balloon, but we don't get this balloon, we took a different balloon. So, again, you can see, initially, we started with putting the catheters into the internal iliacs. Again, these are types of cells. Again, 20-year-old woman, second pregnancy, first is 2 years ago, antenatal imaging, abnormal presentation, after 8 weeks. So, technique is bilateral femoral punches. This is a technique. So you can see the both arteries here. Volumes are there, you can see. So there is a balloon, this side is internal iliac and right side. You have to go to the opposite side actually. So this is the other side. So these balloons, they verify and you have to hit them. And again, so they wanted a hysterectomy. So it is a normally a rather than placenta. So they wanted this hysterectomy, so we did. And without minimal blood loss, and it was done. So the placenta time was 30 minutes because that was a too long time. Again, this is one data just I collected, but total number may be large actually, just for presentation I got, just I preparing actually. So, 38-week G4, inflated 20 minutes, blood transfusion nil, complication nil, is a percutaneous. Because it was removed, no? So they performed it. 33 weeks, inflated 30 minutes, and transfusion nil. Again, there is a suspicion, so they asked, we did inflate the balloon. So, this placenta is a normal battle. Another 35 minutes. So, this is a good result actually. So, only issues are radiation to fetus, that's one issue concern. Complications of, again, we had putting a seed and we cannot give liberally the heparin. Because the patient is under the surgery, there is one concern. And again, additional cost is involved. And availability of angiographic equipment. So, I mean, cath lab is a very good cath lab. So, we will not get sufficient cath lab. So, that is our one concern. So, any questions here? Just go through. So, as part of Gankal's road, now there is some going to some other area. The hemoptysis is another area. How the patient die of hemoptysis? Any massive hemoptysis, they have two things. Exsanguination or asphyxiation. So, even sometimes the blood may have 100 to 200 ml. Once it just goes into the lungs, the patient will die. So, two types of mortality, how it comes. Like, these are various pathologies of hemoptysis caused by pulmonary artery is a 10% times, bronchial artery is a 9% times. So imaging is a very good modality for imaging. And when we do bronchial artery embolization, we need the conservative or bronchoscopic treatment. Mass hemoptysis 300 ml or more in 24 hours. Moderate hemoptysis 3 or more episodes of 100 ml or more within week. Mild hemoptysis, chronic or slow increasing episodes. Recurrent hemoptysis. These are the indications treatment for bronchial hemoptysis. In our country, the most common cause is tuberculosis, post tuberculosis. Like in imaging and bronchoscopy, angiogram is ultimate actually. You can see these are the aortogram, these are thoracic aorta, these are all the intercostal arteries. This is a lot of good anatomy. So, sometimes they are ectopic bronchial arteries. This one case, this artery is arising from coronary artery. So there is a lot of ectopics also, ectopic bronchial arteries. We have to be careful, I mean, we cannot inject into a coronary artery. So that is the one area. Some who have seen coronary arteries are bronchial arteries arising from vital blood. So variations. So we can say just one or two examples. This is a 24 hour lying in present with mass hemoptysis. So CT was this, chest X-ray was a small cavity here. See, CT showed this is a cavity. These are tuberculosis case. And CT angio, there is a something, I mean, contrast is seen. So that gives the idea there is an aneurysm. We did bronchial angiograms in the aneurysm here. Very simple, I mean, just inject a gel foam, it will be controlled. That's all. This is another case of massive hemorrhagitis, hemoptysis. This is a pneumonitis, he had a pneumonia, a prolonged pneumonia. You can see on the right side, he was ventilated. These are all the various radiographs. Ultimately, when he had a massive hemoptysis, CT showed This is a contrast enhancing lesion. So here we can see this is a lesion here, enhancing there, partial enhancing. So diagnosis is pulmonary angiogram. This is pseudoaneurysm actually. The treatment is simple. Once you know the diagnosis, this is a pulmonary angiogram. This is a pseudoaneurysm. Just put a coil there and the coil there. That's all. End of it. Patient is done. Now obstructive jaundice for various reasons actually. So simply imaging is mainly the MRCP. Some CT they give a good information. This is a 60-year-old man presents with fever, jaundice, also the ERC pattern. But sometimes you know they endoscopy they cannot they fail to do ERCP. So those situations they refer to us. So this is the case. And patient had a papillary stenosis. It is very simple. It is a benign lesion. You drain it, you dilate the papilla, and in treatment is done. This is another case. The same thing. So this is another case. It is a carcinoma patient. Had a metastasis. They had a jaundice. And just put it from external to internal drainage. But in this case, treatment is, like lung. So catheter should be like lung. Because if you remove that, you will get an obstruction again and that is will happen. So some neurovascular interventions you can say. 6-year-old parents with a recurrent DAA and angiosus, it was done at doctor and everything. So it is a tight stenosis. And there is a strength in there, just put a strength. You see the these are strength. And there is no recurrence of this one. Again, other important thing is there where the advanced labs like this can be usually intracerebral hemorrhage, can be importantly subarachnoid hemorrhage and intraventral hemorrhage and aneurysms. Causes will be aneurysms, events and AVMs. Generally, they present any hemorrhage in the brain. They present severe headache, vomiting, loss of consciousness and neurovascular damage. This was done some years back. A 30-year-old lady and air hostess by the outpatient had a fall while landing. While landing, she had a severe headache and become unconscious. Was shifted to hospital, investigated. CT shows a massive subarachnoid hemorrhage. This was done some years back, 15 years back. So, investigation showed at that time surgery is still developing. So, what will it be? So, this is the aneurysm there. This is the PCOM region aneurysm. Large aneurysm. So the treatment options developed. We started our case in 1998. The first case we did. These are the coils. Yes, I'll show an animation there. How can you show? This is a femoral axis. We go into the arch of aorta. Again, this is a carotid artery. So through, we'll put a micro catheter there. What we'll do is we'll pass a micro catheter. That goes into the aneurysm and will put coils. So this is just aneurysm. So that is it. So in this case, so we did. So this is a we did a coiling here. So this is a post coiling. So you see, this is a coil. So this is a platinum. Only problem is they are expensive. These are platinum made. So no other metal is suitable for to make a coil. So that's why it is a costlier than a gold. That's the problem. So again, all of we did MR and abdomen did MR. So this is good. So another thing is, see, man, is a 20-year-old woman. The cerebral aneurysms are 3% of population will have an intracerebral aneurysm. 3%. So imagine what is the number of patients suffering any in this also somebody will have an. So that is the incidence which was thought they are not there. They are thought perianeurysms, incident is not there in India. So 3% of the population have aneurysms. So this is a devastating issue. So this is a just 28-year-old woman. Headache, vomiting, altered sensory. So this is a subarachnoid hemorrhage. This is aneurysm there from the internal carotid. So this is internal carotid. So, I mean, we do, I mean, filing, so again, this is a roadmap. So, we need a facilities in Kerala where all these facilities are there. So, this roadmap, lab, we did it, they had all these facilities. So, these are post guidelines, these are. These organizations, they do very good. Small organizations, they do better. These are pre guidelines and post guidelines. Again, intracerebral hemorrhages. Is it poorly rolled by non-cases, CT short cervical bleed. This angiogram shows a, this is a vertebral angio that shows a AVMA. So generally, I mean, this is a simple procedure, we access there, we go there, say, you can see this is a microcatheter gone to up to the nidus. Yes, we embolize, you can see this is a post-embolization, the AVMA.
Speaking of this,
properly done CT and CT angio, they give good idea, I mean, what is happening instead of a bronchoscopy. Bronchoscopy, the fear is there, with a lot of bleed is there, you cannot do, and sometimes it has a problem. That's what the pulmonologists feel. They say, I mean, then otherwise go for an angiogram and diagnosis. No, that's what I mean. Usually, whenever they say, do a bronchoscopy, no, there is a bleed, I mean, don't avoid it. It may be beginning of a, I mean, massive bleed.
When there is blood supply, usually the tissue necrosis. So any degeneration, I mean, further problems, have you encountered any time? So far, madam, our follow-up is generally nowadays with a cell phone available. Any small complications will be, you get a reply. So, are a referring gynecologist, any small strike problem, there will be a phone problem. So that's the way I follow up these cases.
Sometimes I got their numbers. I follow them. Yesterday only I rang up after 9 years. That one girl.
Yeah, that's right.
I mean, they sent the report to me actually on WhatsApp. So what is the size of that? I never expect that fibroid will be go so small
after
size.
After how many years?
This 9 years.
9 years.
So always we tell them around 40% will disappear. But some cases where they will be expelled, subendometrial. So there is no fibroid at all. So these are the situations, and the follow-up is okay. I am trying to ring up to them what is happening. But so far, I mean, I have not done any repeat embolization. There is repeat embolization also possible. If there is a ovarian supply, you see, only the fibroid can be partly supplied by the ovarian artery or partly supplied by the ovarian artery. And sometimes totally by the ovarian artery. The problem comes there, how to embolize both ovarian arteries. So that some issues will come. So sometimes we embolize uterine arteries and just leave it. At that time, also in the future, suppose you can embolize again if she presents symptomatically. Those situations, fibroid may not seem to happen as it is expected. But otherwise, I had not a problem. I mean, see, these are started and still literacy is still going on. And what is our experience? Then only we know what is exactly is happening. But there are no complications as such, and there is no fibroid. They have never had any patient also for hysterectomy or all other, no issues. And most of the time they are reduced. And patients come to me after 1 year, 2 years, 3 years, whenever they feel just more than 1 month.
Post-embolization pain and all?
Pain is a one issue. I mean, that is there for 2-3 days. They are giving a block also, and that is a good thing. We are not started yet. Giving a block, you don't need any analysis also.
No, I am not asking about the procedures. Post-embolization pain.
Pain is a structure, because it is a huge tumor, we are devascularizing a large mass. So definitely pain is there. It will be controlled most of the times by 1 week, I mean most of the people. Yes, it is so.
So again, I thank all the doctors and with the practitioners for gathering here this evening. Thanks to all our doctors of Manorama Hospital and our staff for making this program a success.